Now we have the floor open for the most keenly awaited star-studded panel discussion. This panel discussion, as mentioned earlier, would be led by Mr. K.V. Srinivasan, CEO of Reliance Commercial Finance. Now, may I request Suresh Babu, the head of Treasury of Reliance Capital, to come and take over the proceeding for next 90 minutes.
Good afternoon. This is rather the long-awaited session, and perhaps this could be the last but one session for today. Long-awaited in the sense that we all have a very good borrower sitting on the other side and a very big lender sitting on this side. So this is a banker's session, basically, and they are going to talk about the business and financial angles of SME funding. And I have great pleasure in welcoming Mr. K.V. Srinivasan, the moderator of this panel, sir. So please, sir. Mr. K.V. Srinivasan, he has been with Reliance Commercial Finance and Home Finance Company since 2007. Prior to this, he was the Chief Operating Officer of Reliance Life Insurance Company. And Mr. Srinivasan brings with him 2 decades of rich experience in multi-experience and in different functions in the financial sector and consultancy. And he has been a part of the senior management in ICICI Limited and ICICI Prudential Life Insurance and Citicorp Finance. Like his dynamic work portfolio, his education background is also extensive and very impressive. He is a qualified ACA, ACS, and a postgraduate diploma in management from IIM Ahmedabad. Mr. Srinivasan is extremely passionate about traveling, photography, and music. Now we'll call upon to the stage the panel members. Let me have the pleasure of welcoming Mr. Rajendran. Gentlemen, I think as you know, Mr. Rajendran, he is the former chairman and managing director of Andhra Bank. He has taken over the bank during the most crisis situation not in the bank but in the state, because the state was bifurcated into Andhra and Telangana, and being the only leading bank in Andhra, he had to really face several challenges in meeting those crisis there. And unfortunately or fortunately, both the new chief ministers have come out with loan waiver schemes in both the new states. So as a result, being a banker, he had to really, you know, face a tough time with the borrowers maintaining their loan culture. And despite all these challenges, he was able to show fantastic performance in Andhra Bank, because the business has grown from 2.85 lakh crores. That is 23% jump in the business during a short period of 2 years in Andhra Bank. And the market capitalization of his shares are also gone up from 3,350 crores to 4,300 crores. And of course, you know that during those 2 years, the liquidity in the market was very tight and interest rates were very high. Despite these challenges, he was able to improve the net interest margin of the bank from 2.54% to 3.48%. It's a big challenge again. And the bank was also recognized as one of the top 9 efficient banks in the country. And another feather to his cap was he had opened 600 new offices of Andhra Bank. All these branches are outside Andhra Pradesh. And another thing which I was also a witness to this is that he has brought in a lot of cultural transformation in the bank. He has been very successful in the employee engagement, in making door-to-door campaign for all these small borrowers and retail borrowers. And also, he had also started, you know, making dharnas before the borrowers, bad borrowers, of course, for NPA recovery. So these are the transformations he brought in the bank. Please give him a very big hand, sir. I have also great pleasure in welcoming Mr. K.V. Ramamurthy, Executive Director of United Bank of India, please. Mr. K.V. Ramamurthy is the Executive Director of United Bank of India. He just took charge of the bank 3 months back in August 2015. And prior to this, he was the Executive Director of Bank of Baroda, another premier leading public sector bank in the country. And Mr. Ramamurthy is an agricultural graduate with a CAIB, and he joined Bank of Baroda as a probationary officer in 1981, and he rose to the level of Executive Director. He had different functional responsibilities during his long stint with Bank of Baroda. He has rich experience in several areas, and during Bank of Baroda's career, he was also heading the operations of UAE for 3 years. And prior to this, he was the zonal head North Gujarat zone. And he is bringing with him a vast knowledge in operations, products, services, corporate banking, marketing and business expansion. Please welcome him with a big applause, please. Now I have the pleasure to welcome Mr. Srivastav, Executive Director of Corporation Bank, please. Mr. B.K. Srivastav is the Executive Director of Corporation Bank. He is a postgraduate in agriculture from Banaras Hindu University, and he is also CIAB, and he has a lot of fascination for languages because he took the diploma in Tamil, Urdu, and Bengali. And he joined in the Allahabad Bank in 1979 as an agricultural field officer. Then, of course, he had handled, like any other banker, handled almost all the key functional areas in the bank. And some of the main feathers in his cap are innovation in mass banking. And he has also undertaken a study tour of Thailand, Sri Lanka, conducted by Life Insurance Corporation of India. And also, he has conducted a special study in Indonesia on SME financing. So it's a good this thing for all the audience, sir, to get your rich experience there. And he is basically in charge of priority sector advances, which includes SME also in the bank, and the financial inclusion. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. We have another eminent banker with us, Mr. Pawan Kumar Bajaj, Executive Director from Indian Overseas Bank. Mr. Pawan Kumar Bajaj is the Executive Director of Indian Overseas Bank. He also has taken over the charge very recently in March 2015 Indian Overseas Bank. And Mr. Pawan Kumar Bajaj is a postgraduate in science. He is also a law graduate and of course a CIAB like any other prominent banker here. And he holds again many diplomas in human resources, treasury, foreign exchange and international banking. He started his career with Bank of India as a direct recruit officer in the year 1982, and he rose up to the level of chief general manager before moving to Indian Overseas Bank as executive director. Prior to joining Indian Overseas Bank, he was the chief general manager at National Banking Group North, comprising of 10 different zones covering Delhi, Rajasthan, Jammu and Kashmir, Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Chandigarh, all these states. As executive director of Indian Overseas Bank, Mr. Bajaj's portfolio is again very large. It includes MSME to start with, and then large corporate, mid-corporate, international banking, treasury, retail banking, planning, public relations, human relations, industrial relations, personal administration, balance sheet management, risk management, and credit monitoring, etc. Sir, I think except deposits and recovery, you are holding almost all the portfolios. He has a very vast experience in the field of banking, and he's working in various capacities in different places in India and abroad. And he's a good academician, cricketer, market analyzer, apart from a seasoned banker. Please welcome him with a big round of applause, sir. And we have another eminent personality, in-house personality, that is Mr. Shankar Jadhav. Please, from Bombay Stock Exchange. Mr. Shankar Jadhav is the chief strategy officer heading the strategy from Bombay Stock Exchange. He has been with Bombay Stock Exchange. Apart from the strategy management, he is also looking after the legal, commercial, infrastructure, marketing, corporate communications in Bombay Stock Exchange. And prior to joining the Bombay Stock Exchange, he was heading as a CEO of Siemens, Jesco, and Gold Shield Pharmacy, all FMCG companies. And he has done significant contribution in bringing telecom revolution in India with his educational background and experience in electronics, telecom, and management. He is an electronic engineer by profession. He is an engineer from IIT Bombay, and he is also a PGDM MBA from IIM Ahmedabad in finance and marketing. And he is a lead assessor and certified by UK Chartered Engineer Association. Please welcome him with a big round of applause. Now, with these eminent bankers and senior senior personalities in the financial industry, now I think the discussions are going to be very fruitful. Now I request the moderator, Mr. K.V. Srinivasan, to take over. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Suresh Babu. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think the mood has been set in the post-lunch session by Mr. Madhu Prasad and Ajay, saying basically that if you really want to do anything to do with Make in India, you cannot make do without the SMEs. I think that's a very important statement which is being made, because at the end of the day, it is not the large corporates that actually move the wheels of industry. It is the small one-man shows that actually provide employment, that generate the amount of GDP and ensure that the country actually makes progress. India is known as the country of shopkeepers, and it is certainly with valid reasons, because the day only 12% of our working population is employed by the organized sector. 18% is employed by the unorganized sector, including farm labor, etc., etc. But 70% of the working population is actually comprises of entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs could be very large companies, or it could be a one-man shop kind of a thing, mom and pop shop. So essentially, if you want to describe India in one line, we have to be called as a nation of shopkeepers. And that's a very important place that the SMEs actually occupy in the economy. Now, having said that, my job is very easy. I just have to shoot questions and sit back and listen. And rightly so, because the kind of panel that we have out here, I think I'll be too small to talk in front of them. So without much ado, I will start shooting the questions, and I hope you will enjoy it, right? So I think I have broadly had some amount of initiation and understanding about how the SME really functions and so on, because primarily that's what the business that we do at Reliance Commercial Finance, and hence we have a privilege in associating ourselves with this kind of an event, which is intended to do entrepreneurship development and so on. But primarily, one thing I've noticed, that one of the key things that every SME cribs about or complains about is A, availability of funds. Of course, the interest rates, we've already seen some murmurs in the previous session. Some questions were being shot at the Mudra gentleman. But more importantly, I think it is the timely availability and the nature of the funding that is actually important. One of the key factors that I've noticed is that people actually struggle even after getting the money, because they might have borrowed a six-month money and used that money to put up a plant. And when it comes to actually repaying that money off, they really can't sell the plant, because that's actually their lifeblood. So how do they really make the payment? So there is a certain amount of mismatch that tends to develop. So it is not just money or the interest rate, it is also the nature of money, what sort of money that you really want to get. And it's not just debt, it has to be equity as well. So it's a question of the funding mix, which is very important. Now, having extolled the virtues of the SMEs, etc., etc., now there are also a lot of negatives that are really associated with the sector. And it is quite shocking that more than 90% of this nation of shopkeepers actually do not get funding from the formal sector. And these are all RBI statistics, in spite of the fact that SMEs are supposed to be priority sector, SMEs are supposed to be the lifeblood of our nation's progress and so on and so forth. But somewhere there seems to be some kind of a mismatch. So let us now try to understand from this panel how they actually see the SME sector coming across and developing. What do they see their role as bankers, and do they really have some tips for all of us to learn from, and how do we really make our own lives a lot better as SMEs? So let me start this with probably the senior most person on the panel, Mr. Rajendran. Sir, how do you see the entire SME sector actually developing? Because we are now seeing a lot of changes that are coming across the board in all the sectors, and SMEs are obviously no exception. So how do you see the future of the SMEs in the next 4 or 5 years maybe?
As you rightly put it, SMEs have a very dominant role to play in the economy. But from the banker's point of view, today you are the most favored lot. You look at any interview of any chairman coming up in any newspaper, what is your focus area? They talk about SME. Okay. Not only the banks, but also the NBFCs today are focusing only on SME. What has happened was SME had a 5% NPA in those days, when corporate segment used to have 2% NPA. So all of us were focusing on the corporate segment because NPAs were low. Even today, not that you have improved, you remain at the same 5%, corporate segment has become 8% NPA and another 12% as a restructured asset, which means about 20% NPA comes only from the corporate segment. People are running away from the bigger corporates and looking for SMEs today, because SMEs are more collateralized, and if there is money, these people will pay. I always tell my colleagues, see, who is committing suicide in the market for not repaying the loan? It is a Maharashtra farmer, isn't it? For having taken a lakh of rupees loan and not able to repay, he commits suicide. At least 10 cases are reported every week in Maharashtra alone. Have you ever seen any corporate committing suicide? In fact, we have committed suicide. Many branch managers, many people who lend to these bigger corporates have lended up in ICU, but having lent to them because there are CBA and CBC cases going on. So today the mood is in favor of SME. So if you are able to prove that you are a honest borrower, if you have a good project, if you have good cash flows, getting money is very easy, but not at the price at which he wants. Okay, that we will come to it later on. But as he said, as Srinivasan rightly puts it, availability is much more important than the price in the credit. Availability is there. Every bank is focused only on SME, and it's a golden era for SME in my opinion.
Sir, let me be a little nasty. Huh? Yeah. You said that today every banker is saying SME is the darling, etc., etc., simply because the corporate sector has got 20% NPA. If the same situation were to reverse, would the mood be in a little different?
Suddenly we'll move out. Always people invest in the best performing stock, isn't it? Sitting at BSE.
So it is the best of the bad choices?
That's what I said. Not that you have improved.
Okay.
Suppose if you are able to improve to 2% like a housing loan, today from nowhere 1,40,000 crores is given to housing loan only in State Bank of India because NPA is less than 1%. The only best performing NBFCs in the market is housing finance. So when the NPA ratios goes down, naturally the credit availability will improve. That answers your question also. The credit price is a cost plus contract, right? The cost as which I am getting the deposit, plus the cost of running the credit department and my profit margin added, I charge it to you. Ultimately, the cost of credit includes the cost of NPA also. If SME segment NPA comes down to 2% or 1% tomorrow, the default cost will come down much lower and your pricing will become much finer. It is always the bad boys, it is always the good boys who pay for the bad boys also. Okay. Anyway, NPA borrower will not pay. The good borrower has to compensate for that also. That is how pricing happens.
So one of the takeaways that I get from Mr. Rajendran's statement is that the SMEs have to also look inward to say that how we can actually make things a little better by putting in our own effort. It is not that we can just get away by blaming everybody else. Maybe there is a need also to look inward and say how we can actually become a little more efficient, right? Now, I turn to Mr. Srivastava. Mr. Srivastava, you know, obviously, it is a fact that about almost 50% of the small and medium enterprises actually die out in a matter of 3 to 4 years' time. The mortality rate is extremely high, as Mr. Rajendran rightly put. And this actually puts a lot of pressure on the pricing also, because you have to, obviously, the bad boys will have to be paid for by the good guys. And also it puts the bankers on the mat in terms of their own confidence level to go ahead and take a risk and lend to the SMEs. Now, as a banker, when you on this side of the table, how do you see this sector actually becoming stronger? Are there certain things, how we can as bankers make the SME sector stronger?
SME sector, thank you, Mr. Srinivasan. SME sector is going to be, it will remain strong, because you have indicated in your initial remarks, India moves on SMEs. It is, of course, the whole market or manufacturing system, it is made up of two components, small and medium and micro enterprises, and then big enterprises are there. And throughout the world, if you look at the figures or statistics, you will find even in America, 98% of the enterprises will come under SME sector. It is not that big sectors are there, and there are many countries in the world where 100% of the enterprises, they come under that category only. So it is not that whether it will become stronger. We will have to work together. You have mentioned that we will have to look inward for the bankers also and for the entrepreneurs also. We will have to look inside that what can be done, because these number of enterprises, you can count big enterprises on fingers. You can count very easily, but it is very difficult to. So what is required, we will have to work together, and also mismatch, which we call diversion of funds. You take money from the bank for some purpose. It is not that you are going to misutilize, or it has been diverted for some real estate or like that, which it happens. What happens when you approach the bank, you do not tell properly what is your funds requirement, and bank manager or banker also, he does not takes a good view of what is your requirement. So there is mismatch between the understanding between the two. We find it this gap which exists, and that is what we have been addressing in the banking system. So what you are required and what we are required to do, that we will have to sit together to understand your financial requirement clearly. And another thing which is very important, that either bankers should do or some organization should do, we will have to have some sort of training programs for these people also. We attend so many training programs for ourselves, but there is no such program for small enterprises or micro enterprises. Whatever, it is one man show, you told. It is one man show. He is doing everything from cleaning the office and then sitting in the chair and doing all manufacturing, everything, whatever may be. So it is done by only one person. How these enterprises can be run, that is the main aspect of funding and running of micro and small enterprises. So we will have to, the industry organizations and then your entrepreneurs and bankers will have to sit together. We have got, all the banks have got number of RCTs throughout the country, but those are mostly for micro enterprises. There is no setup for training of small and medium enterprises, and that is what it is required, so that this mismatch doesn't happen and there is no point of mistrust between the entrepreneurs and bankers also. So that is the main thing. And one thing I must make it clear, priority sector tag you have mentioned. Priority sector is not at all for classification of banks, loans and advances. Priority sector is the priority sector of the economy, because it is important for the economy, growth of the economy. That is why it has been called priority sector. There is large amount of misunderstanding about priority sector. You are real priority sector. Farmers are real priority sector. If these sectors don't work, nothing is going to happen in India. And even Maruti or any, for that matter, any big enterprise cannot run if there are no enterprises to make nuts and bolts. So nuts and bolts will be manufactured by you people, and Maruti cars will other bigger cars or other bigger components will be made up by you people. So you are very important. I'm really, I have been thinking why there has been misunderstanding between the bankers and entrepreneurs. We have to look inside for our own system. CGTMSE is there, but we don't find much use of it in the banking system. I do not know whether you people are aware, maybe you people sitting here, you may be aware of CGTMSE, but large number of people throughout the country, they may not be aware of CGTMSE also. And for next 4-5 years, Rajendran sir has already indicated, for next 4-5 years, rebalancing of banks' portfolio, loan portfolio, it will happen, because what has happened to the banking industry during last 4, 5, or 6 years, all the banks are in a process of rebalancing their business portfolio. So you are going to be the point of attraction, and it is up to you and up to us also. It is a joint program. Let us make it to thrive and make it successful, so that India, which is not having roads, you have to supply so many ingredients. We don't have schools, we don't have hospitals, we don't have so many things, electricity we don't have. So all, for all these things, you people are going to supply components, or you are going to provide the services for that. So we are there for the development of small and medium enterprises. I'll call it MSME because micro is also very important. It is not only for Mudra. Mudra program has been launched with a purpose, and that is why, because all those people, if the person who is sitting on the road, who is repairing our shoes, if he is not there, every 6 months we will have to purchase shoe. So that is the requirement. It is just a way of telling the thing. So that is the requirement of the economy. So we'll face your questions afterwards. So thank you.
Sir, thank you. But I think one of the key points...
If I can add some points. So the main reason for this quick mortalities is the insufficient capital, which Ajay mentioned in the beginning itself. Most of the SMEs are not well capitalized. And in the balance sheet, we see a small portion as a capital, remaining portion all as unsecured loans from brother-in-laws and sister-in-laws, so which is not capitalized. Exactly. And once a working capital is released, the first thing is to repay those loans, unsecured loans. Then you are a deficit of the capital in the company. There is no sufficient capital. That is the main reason. Second thing is the technology-related problems, the teething problems which we are having, and you are not expecting that to happen and having sufficient moratorium period for the repayment of the loan that banks are willing to give, provided you are projecting. Giving an optimistic projection in the beginning itself, expecting 80% capacity utilization from day one onwards, and giving a very shorter repayment period, whereas the asset may have a very longer life. So having little lesser repayment, step up repayment later on may help these companies, and not understanding the marketing problems. Because most of the technocrats who was good at production, don't understand the marketing linkages and its importance. These are all the main 4 reasons why the quick mortality happens in the industry.
A very important point. Thanks, Mr. Rajendran. So one of the key things that you mentioned is the, and which of course Mr. Rajendran also supports in a different language, essentially is that the absence of awareness or lack of training or education in terms of specifically financial matters is one of the key roadblocks to progress of the SME sector itself, right?
Yes, I agree with you. Another program which is going on in the country, that is financial inclusion, PMJDY is a part of it, and it is not only PMJDY. Financial inclusion has 2 components, that is connecting you people with the banking and at the same time developing your capabilities, and capability cannot be developed without financial literacy. So these 2 components are very important. It is not for only those people who are doing their business on the roads, in the streets, on in small gumti shop, it is not for, for everybody. Building up capability, it is very important. That is why I have mentioned about financial literacy.
Now, as bankers, how do we further this whole cause of financial literacy? Would it make sense? A lot of banks have started SME cells and so on and so forth. Now, is it a good idea to start a financial literacy cell as well and use that as part of the lending programs to the SMEs, for instance?
Okay, yes. I have mentioned all the banks are having, of course, it is in rural areas. Our cities are there in all the districts of the country. Every bank has got all as per instructions of Government of India. But thing is that I have mentioned already that is being utilized mostly for micro enterprises or at the most for small enterprises. But for bigger enterprises in the MSME whole sector, we will have to have some big arrangement, and all the banks are having some sort of financial literacy cell also. It is not that banks are not having, but we will have to focus because concern of NPA is there. NPA is not only because you people want to default only. It is not at all. Hardly a small percentage of people will default on their will. Default will happen for so many other reasons which may be not in your control, and at the same time you may not be knowing how to control it. So for that, that is why I have requested that industry association, bankers and you people, everybody should come forward so that financial management, it is not for IIM. It is not for IIM, it is for everybody. So it should be established in the financing of MSME.
Mr. Yadav, you know, you obviously are the odd man out. We are all providers of debt capital, and you come from a platform which actually provides for the equity side. And to take Mr. Rajendran's point of undercapitalization further, now, as a equity provider or as a platform provider, what is your recommendation to the SMEs? How they should manage this whole debt equity mismatch? What is the tips that you want to give? How to shore up the equity? What is the right level of equity and debt? You have any thoughts on that?
I believe that it's not the question of only finance. We are here finance people, that's why we are discussing only finance. Most of the times, the MSMEs have one issue. They do not have capabilities of managing a company or an organization. That results into a symptom called not getting adequate finance. धंधा कैसा करना है खाली उसका कुछ एस्पेक्ट मालूम है जैसे टेक्नोक्रेट है तो दे अंडरस्टैंड द टेक्नोलॉजी पार्ट दे मे नॉट अंडरस्टैंड मार्केटिंग अगर कोई मार्केटिंग बैकग्राउंड से है तो ही अंडरस्टैंड द मार्केटिंग बट डज नॉट अंडरस्टैंड द टेक्नोलॉजी दिस ऑल रिजल्ट्स इन वेरियस इश्यूज एंड फाइनेंस बींग वन ऑल्सो मेनी टाइम्स यू सीन इवन टूडेज वर्ल्ड एज चेंज अगर बच्चे को कुछ हो गया तो वी जस्ट टेक हिम टू द चाइल्ड स्पेशलॉजिस्ट अगर औरत को कुछ हो गया तो वी गो टू गायनोकोलॉजिस्ट नो इट्स नॉट रिक्वायर्ड व्हेन द कंपनीज आर स्मॉल You require to look at holistically. And that is what I think is lacking. If banks start teaching or only exchanges start teaching, we will teach you what we can be good at. But what we require, I think, in SMEs is to show how companies grow. How a one-man company becomes a two-man, five-man, ten-man, and how risks are taken. Because, for instance, I think many people today do not understand why earlier companies were started as proprietorship. Then they went into partnerships, then it was a private limited company, and then it became a bigger company. Today, everyone wants to become a Raja on his own, or they want to directly start a private limited company, or directly want to scale up. Hamare zamane mein pehle se leke 15vi tak sikhte the, then we become specialized. Today, people want to be specialized in few years, 2 years, 10 years, 5 years. It's not going to happen. I think that's where we are lacking. But yes, at the same time, remember, apne time pe we were reading from books. Books were not available. Teachers were not available. Today, we have got online systems. I believe the MSMEs, once they realize that they can learn faster, and as Vivas directly pointed out, okay, we require to educate them. None of the SMEs or very few of the SMEs want to default on their own. They actually want to grow because they want to grow. And if we can help them, not only by giving finance, on the risk side, for instance, as you said, adequate capitalization. How many of them know that instead of taking a loan from the brother-in-law, sister-in-law, we should actually make them equity partners? They are scared that the brother-in-law will take away the company and they will have nothing. So we have to explain to them the concept of equity and the shares and how you can make minority shares, sleeping partners, etc. That education, I think, is important, like Biba said.
And also probably one of the key factors is that if you really want to approach, a PE fund or a VC fund, the SMEs most of the times fail because they really don't know how to sell their story.
I'll answer this question. Every organization has an objective, and most of the organizations which are financial in nature, for instance, a bank or a PE or a VC, their objective is to maximize their stakeholders' revenues or profits. So they are not looking at you as an MSME which wants to succeed. They are looking at it, if my limited partners want to keep money for 5 years, what is the maximum gain I can have in 5 years? So what you want to see is, how do I increase my shareholder wealth? And as Ajay Thakur said, that can only come when the MSME promoter sees his company's vision. And in that vision, he sees where things will fall. And if we can help them, I think they will learn this. VCs are not going to fund. In fact, all, whether it's VC or a bank or anyone, which takes money on the basis of collateral, though there's a collateral-free scheme, they are looking at how to safeguard their money and how to get more returns. In fact, when we talk about FDI coming in or any other people putting in money, if you see the contracts, it's very clearly written. If they can't get the money or returns, then at the end of it, at so-and-so interest, they will get all the monies back, which means it's not actually risk financing. We have to have people who take risks, like VC funds, etc. They know that out of 10 companies, only 2 or 3 will survive, so they do take a risk, but they ask your collateral, they ask for your shares, and the price at which they take is very low. So small companies really fear. So we require to have angel investors. So when we have micro units, as you are talking about, more than Mudra Bank, I think the angel investors who are willing to lose money will help the micro companies. And for the SME side, yes, Mudra Bank will help, and including listing on smaller platform, yes, where they are known to others. There's free advertising. People can come on board, advise them. They can see what is happening. And listing really helps.
Listing is very important.
We feel that listing makes you known. It reduces your marketing costs. It gives you some understanding, because people who have invested you, the lowest amount that you can invest as an individual is 1 lakh rupees. So if you invest 10 lakhs, you would go and advise the promoter. The promoter will listen to you. So they get lots of management inputs. So we have seen many companies which are small companies helped by either being listed on our exchange or by angel investors. They really grow much better than those who not.
So sharing of the entrepreneur's vision with the VC and convincing him on the vision is very important. That's probably the most important thing if you really want to attract capital from outside. Otherwise, if you only have your own short-term idea of about 3 months, 6 months, etc., that is really not called vision. I think it's critical. So one has to think long. One has to actually create a vision for oneself in terms of what he would be or she would be 5 years, 10 years down the line, and share that vision and the dream with the VCs or the angel investors or whatever. Only then can you actually expect to get outside equity, and that's very critical, absolutely. And in case of any where you're getting stuck, etc., there are consultants who are available who are actually doing this as a big service. That's very critical. So obviously, managing the equity debt ratio is very important, because you can't get too much equity nor can you get too much debt. So there has to be a fine balance that has to be worked out for each of the enterprise. That's very important. And I think earlier session also, there was a lot of talk about transparency. I think Ajay touched upon this, that if you are not going to disclose what you are really earning, I don't think there is any way you can actually get equity. Because the first thing that the external equity partner will look at is that, are you really an unscrupulous person or are you somebody who's trustworthy? I think that is very critical. So paying off taxes in a open and honest manner is probably the biggest investment that you can do into your own business. It's not to be seen as an expense, but it should be seen as your equity investment into your own business. If you see that way, transparency will actually start to flow, and that will actually go from one thing to the other. And the last thing any banker, for that matter, wants to know, interact with is a person who really doesn't know where his business is going. So that's very important. So vision, transparency are very critical for us to attract external capital. Thanks. Now, See, India itself is now undergoing a huge amount of change. There was a time when we were primarily an agrarian economy. You know, agriculture used to be the most important profession in our economy. Today, agriculture is all but 18% of our GDP. And it will go down to single digits before we even realize it. Now, what sector has actually grown ever since the Y2K hoax actually hit us in the late 90s and the early 2000s is the services industry. So today, India is primarily a services market. Now, the problem that as a banker that I think many of us would be facing is that services typically do not have assets in their business. It is very easy to lend to a manufacturing sector because you will have plant and machinery, land and building, blah, 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 which can be taken as collateral and money can be lent on it. How do I lend to a BPO, for instance, or a manpower consulting company, or a tourism company? So these are all the new age companies that are actually coming across. Now, my question to Mr. Pawan Bajaj is that as a banker, how do you see this trend actually developing? And as a banker, how is your bank and you are gearing up to address the financing needs of the new age SMEs?
Yes, Mr. Srinivasan, your question to this basically means start of this 2000 year, this particularly services industries, you named IT industries, BPO industries, that was not the case that bank has not taken exposure to these industries, but means whatever exposure was taken, it was not means gave that kind of return to the banking because most of the service sector industry, they failed. In whatever debt they took, they were not able to pay. Even in fact, they were also not knowing, yes, what kind of sales growth and during this, by providing various services, they can get it. I can vouch in early 2000, when this particularly IT industries things means loans were given, bank means could not visualize that what kind of names they will survive and for a long. And particularly in that also, in services industry, it is a game of basically a big turnover. If you are able to sell your things means globally very well and it is taken by the other players very well, then only you can make the money in that. And the rightly said by Mr. Srinivasan, because it is not backed by the any asset creation and whatever these services they are providing, in case of failure, we are not able to realize those things. And these particularly industries were started by the new entrepreneurs. They were also not having those kind of capital when they started. And at the initial state, capital was very less. So when the time passed, bank means seen their exposure and experience, so they were a little bit hesitant to further advance all those kind of industries. But right now, if you see in services industry also, IT, I don't know any IT industries, they come for the funding requirement because most of the companies, they are very, very liquid. In fact, on the liability side, we go to them and take money from them. In fact, they don't need, but only this is happening in the case of all known big corporates. But mid-size, small corporates, yes, again, problem is there, but you have to visualize, understand their mechanism under which they are working, whether particular demand is there or not. Suppose in IT industries itself or a small BPO industries, you have to look at what is their model. I know in Bombay itself, in my previous bank, we financed one BPO company which was taking basically cases of IT returns of all US citizens. In fact, we when saw their model and understood that, yes, it was a good model and even that company is still surviving and making good and every year they are adding many further clientele to their companies. And not only this assessment part, but other information on the refund side, other things they are providing to that. So it's basically you have to understand their model. What is the income in that? Whether whatever means loans they are taking from the banking industries, whether they will able to service the interest as well as pay back their loans amount or not, that we have to see. So banks are not akin to financing that, but overall experience to that industry is not good. And earlier part, a lot of NPAs were also there. It was very difficult to realize those. But where bank feels, yes, we can finance, looking into their working and where they are doing the business, definitely we can do that.
So one thing which I heard you saying was that it is not good enough to look at the assets that they have. In fact, they may not have any assets at all, but it is more important to see where their cash flows are coming from. So that is the most important thing that a banker can latch on to.
The only way means we can look at their repayment plan and whatever money bank is giving, whether they can pay back or not. It's basically backed by the cash flow. And I think in many cases, you can judge that also, how much per services they are charging, what is the quantum available, what is the scope in that. I think if appraisal part is good, we can do that. That's not a problem.
Sir, one follow-up question. Now, obviously, today the darling is e-commerce as a sector. Now, how as a banker do you see opportunities for lending there?
To e-commerce.
Yes. E-commerce and the related sectors. Obviously, e-commerce has got a lot of ripple effects.
See, particularly to e-commerce, because now the game is not means few crore of rupees. If you see the investment part, Amazon.com, Flipkart, Snapdeal, lot of money is required. I don't think so. At the initial stage, any banking sector is going to finance in that way. The kind of investment they are getting from the private equity players, like billions of dollars they can mobilize in no time. So that kind of basically market depth is available. And the main thing is the players who can really understand the model, definitely they are going to finance that. But from the banking point of view, I don't think so right now. We are in a place to judge their need and finance all those kind of things. But the related industries, particularly we are today talking on SME, that they are going to supply their good products to these, particularly e-commerce company, yes. Wherever model is good and we can see, yes, they can recover their cost factor plus whatever profitability they have envisaged in the project, definitely we can do that. And of course, through e-commerce, definitely they can increase their sales. But main thing, we have to see whether they are able to recover the cost or not. Because in most of the cases we have seen, particularly you take mobile, means they are selling the mobile, but initially they are selling at a lower cost, whatever the manufacturer cost is there, and they are incurring the losses just to make the brand. So if that is the thing, definitely we cannot come into that way, but definitely any particular SME model is good enough to supply them the things and market is there, bank will take up those cases.
So while a banker may not be seeing opportunity in funding a Snapdeal or an Amazon or a Flipkart, the people who are supplying through those e-commerce portals are definitely an area of opportunity for the bank,
yeah,
right?
Definitely.
Provided, obviously, if they make money, right? That's right. Very important. Okay. That answers a fair bit of question about the emerging India and so on and so forth. I think one of the funny things is that, you know, SMEs, we all talk very nicely about it, and there is a priority sector tag attached to it, as you rightly said, it's priority for the country and so on and so forth. Now, the moment you start talking about priority sector, sir, my question is to Mr. Ramamurthy, is, you know, sometimes, you know, it's a very peculiar thing that any credit card that you get for free, you almost never use it. And anything that comes to you for free or at a concession, you don't give it the kind of value. Now, a priority sector attached to an SME loan, is it really helping the banker to lend more, or is it hindering the progress because saying, "Arey, arey, the priority sector, paisa banega nahi."
I think, thank you, Mr. Srinivasan. You're touching the nail at the right point, in fact. As Srivastav already put it, private sector today has lost its relevance in terms of bankers. For me, any tenable activity where I am sure of getting back my money in a reasonable period of time. I think that is what I am interested. Unfortunately, SME is one such sector which could not really get the right attention because of maybe 110 reasons. That must be the reason. Very fact is that SME concept, the terminology itself, is evolving. SME, when I joined the bank, it was only SSI. It was so cool. SSI requirements were simple, plant and machinery was required, and working capital. And then again, micro enterprises joined. Then again, medium enterprises joined. And then some agro-based enterprises getting into SME sector today. And the next year, if I say, some of the SME units getting out of the sector. SME per se is the segment which is again evolving. And as you say rightly, giving employment to so many people, starting from Kanyakumari to Kashmir, the units are available, SME units. Starting from Kutch, Gandhidham, to almost northeast, SME units are scattered. They are as diversified. Numbers, as somebody said, 6 crore entrepreneurs are available. On the contrary, good or bad, agriculture continues to get the right attention, preferred attention, whatever attention, stably, because their requirements have not changed. Whether I finance a paddy farmer in Kanyakumari or in Western UP doesn't make a big difference for me. For a typical vanilla banker like public sector guys, there is not much of risk involved in that. I don't see much risk involved in funding that project. Or at least bigger projects, when it comes to the question of big manufacturing units, they come with a presentation so that they are prepared to answer 200 answers for my 50 questions. Unfortunately, SME is one such sector where, first instance, SME customer chooses to knock the door of the banker while fighting the fire. He don't allow us the time to understand the proposal he has in his mind. Even if he approaches in time, most of the answers for the questions, probable questions, which I have, very stock questions. What is the unit which you are going to do? What is it you are going to produce? Where from you are going to get the returns? Whom you are going to sell? Ultimately, what are the machinery required? What is the cost of the machinery? And at the end of the day, if you are investing a 2,000 rupees for 2 lakh from you, 8 lakhs from me, 10 lakh, in how many years you are confident of getting back? These questions are only I am asking. And most of the bankers sitting in branches, they will be asking. For them, very primitive stage, somebody approaches, he will say, I am not very sure. If somebody says, very sure of those things, I think he will have only 2 days time left for making payment to the supplier. Or otherwise, most of his receivables would have been struck and he is on the verge of closing the factory. That is the time when he comes. The real issue, as far as I am concerned, I have seen 34 years of banking across the country. SME suffers on account of these legacy issues. Yes, today, for the last 1.5 years, entire country, rulers, regulators, bankers, and Rajendran sir rightly put it, today my coming from Calcutta is a live example. Representing United Bank of India, I am participating in a SME seminar here, maybe at the instance of Suresh Kumar's invitation, but still I am anxious to grow in SME. SME sector per se is not having that much of potential in East or Northeast, where I am very strong, but still I have a feeling that I need to be seen. I need to be present. The need is so visible. And only thing is, 1.5 years continuously we have been talking about SME. We have been talking about Make in India. These campaigns, we have been built up almost a euphoria here. A hype has been built in. Simultaneously, if we can bring people together to form into associations, to form into some sort of professional groups, and then talk to the bankers well in time, and structure the proposals well in time, so that we will be in a position to take care of the requirements of this particular sector. For me, this is the major area is bankers so far, colleagues of my age, we don't understand the SME prospective customer, or even if I understand the prospective customer, his proposal he will not allow me to understand and give me time for me to fund it. If that happens, absolutely, this sector is bound to have best of the best times. Thank you.
So,